The next item of business is topical questions. And at question number one, I call Carol Mockin.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to recent reports that treatment for ovarian cancer is a postcode lottery and has left some women with no option but to pay for private healthcare.
Minister Jenny Minto.
Thank you. Cancer quality performance indicator data published in May covering patients treated between October 2018 to September 2020 showed apparent variation in survival rates. Regional cancer networks have undertaken improvement work to reduce ovarian cancer surgery waits. The Scottish Government continues to monitor these activities and support progress in improving overall care for ovarian cancer patients. The NHS continue to prioritise cancer care, and where there is an urgent suspicion of cancer, they make every effort to ensure a patient is seen quickly, with median waiting times to treatment for those on our urgent pathways being 4 days.
Carol Mockin.
Thank you. I thank the Cabinet Minister for that answer, but I am dismayed to read the reports in the Sunday Post which clearly detail a two-tiered health system where the wealthy can afford treatment and even those on average incomes have little choice but to spend most of their savings on surgery to keep them alive. If you're poor, it seems your options is to hope against hope you can get surgery on the NHS before it is too late. As we know, ovarian cancer is often detected very late and receiving treatment in a timely manner is absolutely imperative if patients are to have positive outcomes. Can the Minister detail how this situation has come to pass and what they will be doing for women who have had to spend so much money simply to save their own lives?
Minister.
I thank Carol Mockin for her question, and I read the same article that she's referencing. And I absolutely understand the concern that this is causing. And we have met with clinical leads to understand current practice and how we can continue to improve outcomes. Improvement work has already started, and we've got the Scottish Ovarian Cancer Clinic Networks has set out some immediate actions, but also some short-term actions. For example, including increasing theatre capacity, and also mutual support between health boards.
Carol Mockin.
Thank you. It has been 2 years since the Women's Health Plan was announced in an effort to tackle health inequality. I put it to you that there has rarely been a time since the foundation of the NHS where it has been so dangerous to be a woman who is not well off in Scotland. And depending on where you live, the situation could be even worse. What immediate and urgent action will this government take to stop the postcode lottery and restore confidence to people waiting for life-saving intervention?
Minister.
I thank the member for her follow-up question. As I outlined, there are immediate works that we are doing with the health boards. And I think we should also just remember about the Women's Health Plan that this is the first Women's Health Plan across the four nations of the UK. And the start of it was creating conditions for change and developing a sound foundation for us to ensure that women's health needs are considered in all future government policy and also NHS Scotland policy. I think it's clear that this plan focuses on a specific set of objectives, which were priorities outlined by inequalities, evidence of inequalities, and also where women have told us improvements are needed. I accept and do recognise that ovarian cancer isn't specifically mentioned in this iteration of the plan, and future aims and priorities will be developed in collaboration with women and girls.
Evelyn Tweed.
The Scottish Government's new cancer strategy included a clear focus on providing equitable access to treatment. Can the Minister say any more about the work being undertaken by the Scottish Government to deliver on this goal?
Minister.
The Scottish Government has committed to providing £10.5 million to health boards to improve capacity and access to systemic anti-cancer therapy by 2027. Last month, we published the Monitoring and Evaluation Framework for the Cancer Strategy. This includes a commitment to evaluate the impact of our policy outcomes on health inequalities, though a process of analysing disaggregated and intersectional equality data whenever this is feasible. We are working with the Scottish Cancer Network, as I've said earlier, to implement a national plan that will ensure that capacity and demand are aligned, establishing a sustainable model of service across Scotland.
Question number two, Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to ensure students at Scottish universities receive their degree classifications.
Minister Graham Day.
Presiding Officer, following consultation with its membership, the University and College Union withdrew its marking and assessment boycott at universities across the UK effective from the 6th of September. The impact of the boycott has varied across and within institutions. Now that the boycott has been withdrawn, it's my clear expectation that Scottish universities with backlogs work at pace to complete any outstanding marking assessments to provide the affected students with their final awards and degree classifications. But I want to take this opportunity, Presiding Officer, to thank those students impacted for their resilience during what must have been an extremely difficult period for them, and those across the sector who worked so hard to support those students and to put mitigations in place wherever possible.
Liam Kerr.
I thank the Minister for the answer, and he's right to thank the students and those who support them. But today, 1,670 students at Scottish universities await their degree, and 950 await a classification. Now, as a result, job offers, further education offers, and the joy of graduating will have been lost. So, does the Minister agree that the underfunding of university teaching and research over many years is at the root of this situation? And what does he propose to do about it?
Minister. So let me start with a point of agreement. I do think the impact on students has been deeply, deeply regrettable. But, Presiding Officer, 12 years as an MSP, let alone my time as a minister, I never come across any sector that's satisfied with its funding. And in this chamber, inevitably, the call is that the solution for everything is more public money. And in the most challenging of budget circumstances that this government finds itself in, that's not possible to deliver. But I would point out gently, to Mr Kerr, we do continue to invest £2 billion a year in our colleges and universities, and there is much going on, much work being undertaken by our universities to grow their income away from the principal public source.
Liam Kerr.
I'm very grateful to the Minister, but the growing of income exposes the universities to a lot of international funding, and many of our universities are reliant increasingly on international funding. In this marking situation, could impact on the confidence of those students to come here. So what does the Minister think such a reduction in international students could have on our universities, on both reputation and funding, and how will he prepare for that?
Minister. Mr. Officer, the fantastic global reputation of our universities as such, I think it quite unlikely that the impacts of the marking boycott we've just heard would be as he suggests. But clearly, any impact on international numbers would be an issue. And of course, if that type of action became a feature going forward, then I recognise he's right, there would be a reputational risk potentially for the sector and for the individual institutions concerned. However, I do believe there's a willingness to reset things so that we have more harmonious relationships within the sector between the institutions and the teaching staff. I do think there is an opportunity to do that and to avoid this happening again. Sitting right up there, Presiding Officer, alongside a fair and affordable pay increase for lecturers, and we shouldn't forget the support staff in all of this as well, are the issues of insecure contracts and gender pay gap. And the principals are telling me that I speak to that they are up for addressing these. And I think if we can make progress on those, we can go a long way to bringing peace to the sector.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister will be aware that there is still ongoing disputes in this sector, and when challenged on disputes in the sector, the Government blame university principals and USEA. The Minister is not a bystander or a commentator. He is a Minister, and ensuring students in Scotland get the best education possible is his responsibility. Having degrees classified now and in the future to do this is crucial for this. So can I ask the Minister, what is his plan to sort this out now, and what is his plan to make sure it doesn't happen again?
Presiding Officer, it is absolutely the case that there's not a direct role in this for ministers. Nevertheless, I've engaged with the union, I've engaged with the individual principals, and as I've just outlined, there are things happening behind the scenes which I believe will get us into a better position, not just so that we don't have this repeated again, but that we do have genuine harmony within the sector.
Thank you, and that concludes topical questions. There will be a pause while front benches organise themselves.